Okay. I'm here today with a pastor from mainland China, Peter Wang. He's from Dalian, which is in northeastern China. And today we're going to hear some stories. Now, it's not often that you hear about Christians in China from their own stories, from their own mouths. And today we have a great opportunity. We have a few other people that are here that are going to be interviewed. And I'd like to just say welcome. And how are you enjoying the conference? Tell me a little bit about your feeling about this particular conference.
Yeah, so my background is Presbyterian. So when I was a young Christian, my pastor only taught me Bible and nothing else. But when I have been a pastor, I face a lot of challenge and temptation. God's word is good, it's powerful, but not enough. So I need the Holy Spirit. This is the reason I come to attend this conference. I want to be anointed by the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, and me too. And all of our friends all over the world. Yes. So I'm going to ask you to pray for the people that you're hearing their stories. Now, before you became a Christian in the university, and tell us a little bit about that. What was your family like? Life before you became a Christian, and why did you want to hear about Jesus?
I think my family is a standard Chinese family. They, in fact, they love each other, but they don't know how to show love. In fact, they love each other, but most of their speaking is created quarrel and could not have the acceptance in part. Also, they love their kids, they do not know how to show love, to let the kids feel acceptable. So a lot of hurt and troubles.
Okay, now did you practice any other religion when you were growing up? Was there anything you believed in? What did you believe in?
Of course, in fact, my parents, they didn't have any religion because they were busy working to get money to support family. But when I was a young boy, I know I'm not Superman, I need help. And because my parents, they are busy working, no time to help me to spend time with me, so I'm searching some supernatural ways.
Okay. And you met somebody on the college campus, you went to college, and you met someone. Tell us about that. Who was he, and how did he approach you? What did he say?
He is a missionary from South Korea. He, when he was very successful in his career, he prayed before Lord, and Lord showed himself to him and told him, go to China to tell my name to the people there. So then he gave up all his career and went to China to be a missionary. It's a great man.
And was he like coming in as a teacher, or was he just there as a businessman, or was he just as a tourist? Well, how was he?
Yeah.
How did you meet him?
You know, at the beginning, it is hard for you to be a teacher or be a business in China. But he chose to be a student who wants to learn Chinese. Then he had an opportunity to stay on campus.
Oh, so he was actually speaking Chinese. Now, you didn't become a Christian right away. You must have studied the Bible. And at what point did you actually believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior?
I think the key point is the sacrifice, the love. So there's one God who loved me. Because he loved me, he died on the cross for me. I think this is totally changed my life to know the concept of love. In the past, I love you because you know somebody can do something for me. I love you because you did something for me. But he loved me not because I did what I did for him. Even I didn't know him, but he loved me, because for me. So this is totally changing my life.
And also, you were telling earlier to me that this missionary had a family life that you admired. Can you tell us about that, and that had a big impact on you?
Yeah. So because in my own family, always day by day, quarrel, fight between my parents and myself. Even there's a little fight between my and younger brother, so too troublesome. When I visited their family, I was surprised because they were gentle to each other, they were nice to each other. So we can see they support each other. Always, I hear the speaking from the parent, the father, you are my good son, you are doing great, go continue to do that. Mm-hmm. So I never hear about that from my family. Always, you did it wrong again, don't do that again. So no next time, I will beat you.
So there was like unconditional love, you saw unconditional love. And then after that period of time where you were studying the Bible with him, tell us what happened to after he left, and how did you continue to grow as a Christian?
Yeah, so this is very, very thing I give thanks to Lord. This man led me Christ before he left China, just 1 week before he left China. So even he gave me Bible, but I could not understand. Even he asked me to pray, but I know how to pray. Even he asked me to go to church, but because the church is so far from the temple, so as a young student, I want to save more money. So I didn't read Bible, didn't pray, didn't go to church. But praise the Lord, that man who led me to Christ, he continued to pray for me, and one day he called me again, I should introduce a friend to you, and you should meet him. And this man introduced a pastor, a missionary pastor to me, and that pastor led me to Bible study, one to one for 4 years. And that really opened my eyes to know who the God is.
Now, outside of China, in many countries around the world, the normal way is you want to know more about Jesus Christ, your faith, and you go and you find a church, and then you go into a church and they have all kinds of programs. So tell us a little bit about China, with the church in China. Are there churches easy to find, and what's the difference between the churches, and why didn't you go to a church? You said it was too far away, but I'd like to hear a little more about that.
Well, because in China, we have very strict religious policy, so all the Christians are limited to worship God only inside the registered public church, we call three self church. But because the government won't control the religion, so they do not give you a chance to build more building. So we only have very, very limited old small size church building in some area of the town. So usually it is easy for you to find the three self church, public church building. But instead, through all the people, even back to the door, you cannot find a seat. This is one kind. The second is, in fact, I've been to half church. Now I'm going to half church. I start a half church to lead a church. So we do not have any brand. We do not have any building. It's hard for people to find a church. So you must have a friend or a relative who are Christian, who are that church member, then they will lead you to that church. No sin, no.
So out of the billions of people in China, God sent you one person to find you, is that right?
Right.
Holy Spirit, isn't that wonderful? We serve a wonderful God.
Amen.
Amen. Now tell me a little bit about, is it difficult to get Bibles in China when you were first became a Christian? What was that like? Someone gave you a Bible, but can't you just go buy a Bible in a bookshop?
Yeah, I think this is we should give thanks to the Lord. When I was a young Christian, it is hard. It was hard to get Bible. Later, we interview an old preacher, and he went to a far remote village. Before she was leaving, she needed a box of Bible. Anywhere in town, she could not buy the Bible. But God gave me some channel. I found a box of Bible. I gave her, support her. But now it's a little better. At least you can buy one copy of Bible, but you cannot buy a box. You cannot.
Just buy one by one?
Yes.
And do they record your name when you buy a Bible, or are they just easy Bible?
Now it's a little better, they didn't record your names. But in the past, they really do that with the three self church, because only three self church has the right to sell out the Bible. So they will record your names.
And how about books that are not Bibles, like Christian books or Christian music CDs? Are those, can you buy those in China, like things to help your spiritual growth, your spiritual life, marriage, and these kind of things? Are those easy to get in China?
I think half. So, some Christian background books, but they are focused on family, focused on children education. it is easy to get ISBN number. So this kind of book you can buy from the Christian bookstore. But some very big, sound Christian books, like theology, like talking about the history, the revelation, this kind of book still rejected by us.
So that's the teaching. That's the teaching book. Now you said Christian bookstore. Do they have Christian bookstores in China?
In China, most of the big city, they have small set of Christian bookstores.
Wow, I didn't know that. That's really a praise God for that. That's a recent development, right? Not something they did before.
Yeah. With regard to Christian bookstores, we ask you to pray fervently because the Christian bookstores, because they are small size, they do not have too many products for the people. So it's hard for them to get money to support their own. So from my understanding, almost 90% of Christian bookstores, they are losing money day by day. But why they continue to run the bookstore? Because they want Christians to have chance to read more books about God. So this is a work of faith.
Now we heard Pastor Peter's testimony in his early life as a young man. And then what drew you to become a pastor? You were actually studying to be an engineer and in the business world. Tell us a little bit about that transition from going from the business world in China to going to becoming a pastor.
I think this is a very standard question, and I will give you a very standard answer. First of all, God's Spirit through my heart. Even at that time, I'm not a Pentecostal background, but I know there's something stirred in my heart. So I know to be a pastor is meaning to do a great work. But I didn't follow that calling. I allowed the world, I allowed getting much more money. So after graduation from university, I had a job from Caterpillar, a nice position, a good salary. But God continued to do His work, to finish His will. So which means He closed almost every door before me. So no way for me to go forward. So I have to lie down, oh Lord, what should I do? So He gave me a calling, a second chance. Come to me to serve me, to let the people know me, because you are still my neighbor. You should let people know this news. I love you, I love all the world.
Well, you mentioned that you're Pentecostal. Tell us a little bit about the different denominations, or how does that work in China? There are many different kinds, and also the cults and all the things that are working, the false word of God. Tell us a little bit about that.
Because the strict religion policy, so in China, any kind of church, they were underground, which means they can do something to be hidden from the government. In that case, sometimes they could not receive systematic theological training, they could not have a big network to share the resource. So some leader will have the wrong thought, have the wrong teaching, and they can just spread the wrong thought, wrong teaching. So in some area, this is very serious. So the whole church, they worship God, but they don't know God exactly. And because of that, we produce some local cult. Local for example, we call Dongguang Shandian. So they split many churches in Vietnam. Even now in some big towns, they seem happy.
And part of that too would be there's not enough teaching books. As Pastor was sharing with us, there's not enough available, or they're none available, so they're not able to get teaching. But there are people that are going into China that are leading like Bible schools and Bible colleges and things like that underground to up-train the pastors, is that correct?
Yeah. We have some underground Bible school, but usually the size is very small, and the students could not meet the need of fast-growing church. So.
And why would you say that there's so much opposition or against the Christians in China. Why are people not supporting the Christians?
I think this is many reasons, but one or two I can think about that is, first of all, our government is they doesn't believe in any God, but not right, they believe in money. So in this case, they will promote the whole society to run after materialism. Secondly, because the inside our society there are so many social problems, so the government fear a big group of people. They don't fear one person against them, but they fear a big group of people against them. So any kind of big group, if they are well organized, the government fears them. So I think this two main reasons the Christianity is still being rejected in our society.
Well, we're meeting today, the last few days, here outside of mainland China. We're actually in Hong Kong, and we have 1,500 in attendance, mostly mainland Chinese Christians. That wouldn't be allowed in China, right? This kind of meeting would be very difficult or not allowed to have a meeting like this with so many people worshiping God. Would that be possible?
In China right now, not possible. But I believe later on God will open doors so we can have a big gathering. Recently, I know the one church in Beijing, they held around 1,000 monks members, and now the government gives them big pressure. They have to split.
Right. Okay. Well, this has been a very interesting talk. Can you share with us about the forms of persecution that exist in China against Christians?
I think this is the topic of always be mentioned. So in China, we have the big size, different parts have different policy. So in some place, it's a little harmony. The policemen, the religious department, they do not give too much pressure of any persecution to the church. But in some place, they do harshly. For example, under 2009, three famous church pastors, one from Shanxi, one from Beijing, one from Shanghai. They were the pastor from Shanxi, they got arrested for 7 years in jail. Beijing pastor is half arrested, and the Shanghai pastor kick off China.
That's why we need to pray for the pastors and their families. It's not easy there in some ways, for sure. So what do you see? Now tell us a little bit about your church that you actually are pastoring now. Can you share with us about your church? We'd like to pray for you.
Okay. So our church is it's a very standard new urban church in downtown China. We have around 100 people, and half of them are college students, and half of them are professionals. Even we do, but still we have some other people from different society level. But last year, September, our church got persecution from the local government. Because of that, half of the church members scattered. So now we only have 30, 40 people regularly get together. But these people, they love God. They facing the persecution. They stand up firmly for Christ the Lord. Now we got new revelation. We want to focus on the youth ministry, because in China, many young people, they don't know what is love. They don't know how to deal with the life problem, because one child policy, they have many big psychological and emotional problems in their heart. So now our church wants to do that kind of ministry to save Moses for God's kingdom. So I think this is why I urge you to pray for our church, for our coming on ministry.
So that's one thing that's a little bit different than many places in the world. Because there is persecution there through various sources, the authorities, then the people in the church, some of them will leave the church. They can't handle the persecution. So that's a very much of a strategy that they're using to divide the church and make the church weaker. So we definitely need to pray for those people. And as a pastor, what do you need prayer for, your church and yourself as a pastor? What's the prayer points that you would need so we can pray for you?
So I think as pastor, we have a family need. This is not financially, but spiritually, because so many temptation from downtown life. So every day we not only pray for the people, we also serve some people with big problems. So there's a lot of spiritual conflict, spiritual warfare in our life, in our ministry. So in the case, I hope you can pray for my wife, for my daughter, for the unity of my own family, because my own family should be an example to the whole world, not only to the church families. There's a God, and God protect us, God protect our family. God bring glory from our marriage, I think. So please pray for that.
Now I have one last thing I'm going to bring up, and then I'll just thank him. We have some other interviews to conduct, but I'd like to say, you mentioned the campus, that you have an outreach to the campus students. Tell us a little bit about the students. That's really the future of China, what's happening with the students, and they're open-minded. And we want to hear a little bit about your campus outreach. Tell us what's on your heart, how do you do it, and it'd be interesting to hear around the world.
Yeah, we have a right now, we have two kinds of campus ministry. One ministry is focused on bachelor degree students. So we will have some key students who are very active Christian student Christian leaders. So they will preach gospel to the unbeliever Christian students, and they will teach them some basic Bible course, and later on lead them to the church. This part we cooperate with the campus process of Christ. And also we have another ministry focused on the graduate school, the master degree, doctor degree. We just establishing professor, let them to bring such input to their students who are doing master and doctor degree research. Yeah, and later on we will have a third campus ministry, because now China government want to raise up the reputation of our university. So they want to get more and more international students. So I think this is a good chance we can get some solid Christian mission to be our international student, to do master degree or doctor degree research. And at the same time, we have an opportunity to live in China, to live on campus, to share gospel, to lead a fellowship on campus.
Do you feel that there's a spiritual hunger for a Christ, or a spiritual hunger? Do the people in China really have that passion, would you say?
I should be honest, compared to the 1980s, 1990s, now the spiritual hunger is not so very eager, so a little cool down. So this is what we should pray, and only when God stirs the heart, we have a spiritual eager hunger for Christ.
Right, because there's materialism taking place there now in China, so people are thinking that way. And then also, I think because of the social problems that they have, many kind of difficulties as far as living, they're actually wanting to know Christ. They're wanting to know something that will help their life. So that's where that takes place. And we just want to thank you, Pastor Peter, and we just want to continue to pray for you, brother,
yes,
and your city,
yes,
and Dalian, and thank you very much. So take care of yourself, and we'll keep praying for you.
Thank you, and thank you for your prayer.
God bless you.